Police Department. He's been there 17 years, and he has put together a presentation based in part, I'm sure, on what they've learned, both from theory and unfortunately from practice, about scams and other identity theft issues. So Steve, thank you very much for joining us, and without further ado, the floor is yours.
Can everybody hear me, or? Good? Okay. So, this is about internet-related crimes. How many have gotten those phone calls from the IRS?
Yeah.
They're horrible, aren't they? So, this is kind of some stuff to protect you against those kind of calls. But also, they do it internet-based, cold calls. I was actually sitting at my desk one day at work, and I got a call from some guy. He said, "You have a virus on your home computer." I'm like, "Okay, cool. How much is that going to cost me?" And they hung up right away. At my house. So how do you know? So
they told me it was Dell.
Yeah.
Usually
so
Microsoft.
Mine was like HP or something. So this is how to protect yourself from internet theft and identity scams. You're going to see a lot of stuff from my boss because he gets scammed all the time. That's awesome. I'll point him out. And these are some of the older, statistics. But as you can see, how much internet crime complaint center. Do you guys know what IC3 is? It's actually a website you can go to. You can lodge complaints on the internet against it. Like if you get a spam email, you can send it, or you get contacted by somebody saying they're from IBM and they want to fix your computer. You go to IC3 and you lodge the complaint with them, and they'll be able to look into it. And it is only IC3, so. You can tell how many in 2011, there are over 314 complaints to that. 2015, 288, and then in 2015, 269.
On that ICC.
IC3? Yep.
Is that IC3 what?
If you just into Google, just put IC3 or internet complaints, it'll take you to them. I don't know if it's a .com or .org.
That's what it's going to
be. Yeah, I don't know if it is, but if you type in Google, just IC3, it'll take you to it.
Okay.
So a lot of complaints. I'm sure in 2016 there were a ton more, and in 2017 there will be just as many.
Back up?
Okay. Awesome. Here's some more statistics. Oh, did that switch? Yes, it did. So, yeah, a lot of money was lost, huh? Total estimated. A lot of money. But again, that was back in 2015. People are becoming smarter. Programs like this, getting out there and talking to people, especially letting them know, like the IRS scams, where they're asking for iTunes cards or Walmart gift cards. You know, I don't remember the government taking iTunes cards. And then my favorite, I think, you got it. They're going to come to my house.
And arrest you.
Yeah.
Arrest
you. Yeah. The government's not going to call you and let you know they're coming. They're just going to show up.
Right.
Or they're going to send you a letter. So quite a few complaints have been through 2011, 2015. A lot of money was lost. And a lot of people, what they do is, they'll get a call. Some of the more recent ones that we've had at our police department is, your grandson, your granddaughter, they're in jail. They can't talk to you, but they need this amount of money. And you're like, I don't remember my grandkids going out of town or even to another country. It happens, right?
Or another state, yeah. Where you know where they are.
Right.
I just texted my grandson and said, okay, where are you? Yeah. He said, I'm at work.
Yeah, I'm sitting at my desk. So, and there, the average dollar loss those reported is 317. Usually it's somewhere around 560 a person before they catch on. And we have had people catch on too late. I actually had one where we were working a case, lady up in Caroline North called and said, these guys are coming to my house, I don't want them there. And she believed they were going to come to their house. So we went up there, we sat with her for a little bit. And when they didn't show up, they actually called and said, hey, you need to go get these green dot cards. So my partner grabs the phone and he's talking to them and really running them in circles. And I picked up my phone and started calling it. And it actually went to a voicemail for the American Clearinghouse. Remember those? Yeah. So they're tricky. So this is back in 2015, 1 in 7 incidents of fraud are reported. I'm sure now it's quite a bit more. I mean, we get maybe 1 or 2 a day. And as long as no one actually has any loss, is a report, it's very tough to track down. Our Lake County State's Attorney is awesome, but they're not going to let us go across, out of the state, let alone over the water to go find these guys. So. Here's some top states. Yeah, we're in there. California, Florida, Texas, New York, Illinois.
Well, at least we're at the bottom.
The top five.
So here's the top five reported crimes. Business emails, if anybody's gotten any emails. Anything from the IRS, anything from...
A bank.
What's that?
Any bank.
Banks. Yeah, actually, I took a class when I first started investigations, and it was a guy that he taught these type of classes, and his wife worked for a bank. And she came home and she's like, hey, I got these trial credit cards. And she's like, this is brand new, hot off the press, brand new number, everything. He's like, I bet that number's already out there. So she's like, no way. There was only 5 cards printed with separate serial numbers. She's like, I can find that card on the internet. And within 5 minutes, he found it on like the dark web. He found all those numbers. Yeah. So they're out there before they're even out there. Confidential fraud or romance. That's a big one. I worked a romance one where we actually went to Kankakee County and recovered 5 laptops that were sent by our offender to our victim, and it was a reshipping scam. Has anybody heard of reshipping scams?
No.
That's where somebody will contact you and say, I want to send you 5 computers, and then I want you to send them someplace else. And I'll send you a check. And what I want you to do is deposit that check and pull out this amount of money, and you get to keep the rest of the money for your help. And what happens is the laptops are bought with stolen credit cards. They're shipped to you. The check that they send you is fraudulent. It's not any good. It's going to pass for about a day or two, and then the bank is going to come back and show that it's not a good check, and now you've taken money out of your account that you can't get back, and you've shipped off that amount of money. So, as you can tell, there's a lot of them that go on. Non-payment, non-delivery, again, with the stolen laptops and stuff like that. Investment scams. Everybody's trying to get you to invest in something, right? But definitely, unless you go out and you actually go and research that investment, and you are the ones that initiate it, if anybody calls you and saying that I got a good investment for you, don't take it. And then identity theft. Identity theft is a huge one. Social security numbers that are out there, names, dates of birth, where they're opening up credit cards or loans in your name. Right around tax time, we get a lot of people calling and saying, I've already submitted my tax refund, you know, my taxes for a refund, and they're saying somebody else already did it. So there's a lot of that going on.
That's harder to get rid of. I don't know about
it. It's very hard, and it's really hard for the police department because the IRS won't did get better about that. Just this year, I physically took one. The guy said that somebody submitted said the taxes in his name, and they looked at it, and it didn't match what he had done in the past. So his taxes didn't match this year's tax amounts. And they called him and sent him a message, or a letter, and said, hey, it doesn't match. Is this actually you? And he said no. He sent them a letter telling them no, it wasn't him that submitted that said tax return. And they're like, okay. So they put that one to the side, and he actually had to mail in his taxes instead of doing it over the internet.
That rapid refund, or that's how they can get you, right?
Yep. Yeah, they send it in through the emails.
So in other words, when your tax guy does that, does your taxes, it's a little bit of a risk.
Well, it can be, but it looks like the government's actually taking steps to go, well, this doesn't match your two or three last tax returns, there might be a problem. Identity theft, this is kind of a little definition for it. Fraudulent acquisition and use of personal private identifying information, usually for financial gains. And uses any personal identification or personal identification or personal identification documents of another person to fraudulently obtain credit, money, goods, services, and other property.
I have a problem. I got scammed on the internet, and they went on my Facebook and they took my friend's picture and they went through all my friends and picked a friend off my Facebook.
Yep.
And then I'm getting Messenger with this. I know it's a scam, and I don't know how to get rid of the Messenger that's in my friend's name. I don't know how to get rid of that.
You can contact Facebook directly.
Okay.
And let them know that this other, what you want to do is go to that, if you can go to that fraudulent Facebook page, at the very top, copy all of that information at the very top and send it to them.
Okay.
They can actually disable that. Let them know. And that's going on a lot. Facebook is horrible. Instagram, Twitter, all crazy.
Also, if you get a second request, you can
say,
I'm already a friend of this person, and contact them, and they say, no, I didn't do it, so then you contact Facebook, and it comes up almost immediately.
Yep, they're pretty quick.
Just a quick question about the tax again. Do you have a list of those that are high risk? What I use is I sign in to the IRS and it's called Free Tax.
Yeah.
And
I can't recommend anything, but what I can tell you is personally I've had good some good access with the tax software that's pretty good.
TurboTax,
yes.
This one I have used it, I think, 3 years now. Never had a problem.
Yeah. Some of those are, they certify it and everything. So it's the people that get your information and send it in.
Well, I got to go through IRS to start.
Yep.
Well, I kind of thought,
that's pretty secure.
Yeah, pretty secure.
So this is kind of a definition of what we do with identity theft. We get a lot of them. It also kind of spawns into other things like just recently I had a traffic stop. The lady gave me somebody else's name, and it wound up being she got arrested for identity theft because she used that other person's name. So it kind of spawns in all kinds of different ways. How do your information is used? Your information may be used to open credit cards, utilities, cellular, telephones, contacts, mortgages, fraudulent driver's license, bank accounts, buying a car, getting a job, and then the dreaded filing fraudulent tax returns.
How many of these people do you catch?
Not many of them.
Yeah.
Gotta be honest. Because here's what happens. A lot of them are overseas. We'll talk about getting through here. We'll do Nigerian scams. Those are big ones. But usually everything, what they do is, they won't just contact you from their computer. they'll contact you through their computer, but they'll go through a server that they break into, and then they'll bounce around to other servers. So it's very tough to track all the way back to that one person. Sometimes if they're in the state, we can usually, like, they use somebody else's information, and they're local within the state, we can catch them, because we can get them through IP addresses. So, say they log on to their computer, they're not smart enough to go through a different server system, they go through Comcast. They log on, they open up a credit card in somebody's name, we're able to track back their IP address to find out who it is, whose name it is, and then we can go talk to them and interview them. But often it's very tough. Identity theft, not now computer related. Every 3.5 seconds in the United States, a person's identity is stolen. Chipotle, anybody go to Chipotle? They just recently got hacked, so a lot of their credit card information got released. Can be stolen through low-tech terms. Digging through garbage cans, stolen purses and watches, that's a big one. Conning information out of employees or businesses, and then going through your mail. Digging through the garbage, I haven't seen a whole lot of that, but the stolen purse and wallet, that's a huge one. Always keep track of your purses and your wallets, especially in stores. And recently, yes?
Yes. My friend and I went to Newberry for an all-day genealogy session, and then we took the bus downtown by the water tower and went shopping, and it started to rain, and I got on the bus first, and a guy got on between my friend and me.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and she had a package and she had the purse and she wasn't hanging on to it. I hang on to my purse. I was born in Chicago.
Yeah.
I've been in Chicago. You hang on to your purse. She didn't. The Confederate was, which I think was a woman, was in back of her. He had the umbrella and he was like, shaking off the rain.
Yeah.
Okay? The Confederate got her wallet.
Yeah.
And started running across the street. He followed the bus driver, and one of the passengers saw it happening. They went after the guy and didn't catch him.
Yeah.
Okay. We got off the bus. We waited 30 minutes for the Chicago policeman to get to us. By that point, they had gotten to Sears, charged $700 on her account.
Yep.
By the time we were back in Glenview, Northbrook, they had gotten into her bank account.
Mm-hmm.
They had done all this other damage.
Yep.
And it took a while for her to get the money back.
Yeah.
You know, for that.
And
as far as we know, they never caught the guy. I mean, it was that quick.
Yep. Well,
you know.
And even if we get, like in those cases, we go back to the store and we get video surveillance and we get a picture of that person, it's very tough to, you know, identify a person unless they're doing a lot of them and they've been arrested before. Stolen purses and wallets. Yes, sir.
Related subject. To what extent are those protections for putting your cards in a wallet locks reading the cards?
Yeah.
Any idea how effective they are?
I don't. I've never worked with them. Don't know too much about them. But something I will look into.
Yeah, I think with this wallet.
Yeah. It might. I mean, I think there are card readers that they walk good. Behind you. And, yeah.
Is the chip safer than the credit card for those two?
Really don't like the chips.
Yeah, but they're good. A lot of people are using them.
Yeah. I'm still leery on them. I haven't seen enough data to say they're safe.
Another thing about stolen purses, crazy young women, they go to soccer games, leave their purses in the cars, and tons of purses were stolen at games here around here.
Yep.
Because they're stupid enough to leave their purse in the car. And the guys just go around the cars and break in and get all crazy.
Yep. Well, one of the big things is there's actually a group out there called the Felony Lane Gang. to Illinois. And usually what they hit is they'll go sit on kinder cares or daycares, and they'll watch moms pull up to the front, and now they're just dropping off their kids. So they're going to be in there for 5 minutes, maybe less. They leave the doors unlocked. So these guys pull up, they open the door, they grab the purse, they drive away. No sooner do they drive away, they have about 3 or 4 other females that they are dealing with. They take the checks, and they will go to different banks, and they'll hit the outside lane where there's a less chance of a camera being there, and they'll put these checks in for thousands and thousands of dollars. And it'll come right out of their account, and they'll get the money. And we are, it's very tough to catch them. I think we've maybe caught 2 or 3 in the last 3 or 4 years of these guys.
But the latest thing I've heard about is when women are getting gas.
Yeah.
And if they leave their door unlocked, somebody comes along the other side of the car, reaches in and grabs their purse.
There's actually a video out there, I just saw it the other day, of a guy, girl gets out, does that, they pull up, they sneak around the car.
Right.
She actually jumped on the car, instead of trying to steal the car too. She actually jumped on the car and the guy finally got out and
I know, I
ran.
That.
Yeah.
Do you have a problem with gypsies?
With?
Gypsies.
No, we don't see a whole lot of gypsies up this way. I think it's been probably about 5 years since I've had to deal with them. And the reason we know who they are, they all have the same name. We know exactly where they live. We go to their house, basically.
They have similar names.
Yeah,
they're family names.
Yeah, they're all Eli's or Miller's, honestly. And we know who they are, and the state police watches them. And basically what you do, we go, we talk to them, we confront them. And even if they didn't commit the crime, just to stop us harassing them, they give restitution to the person.
That Medicare card, you know, if you have your Medicare card, it has your, actually has your social security. Yeah. When you go to a doctor's office, there could always be
right.
Receptions could get you, right? Right.
They could.
Well, I mean, but isn't that kind of risky? But
it is.
Because they know it's just got a letter on the end.
Yep. Yeah. Anybody could get it. One of the other things is businesses, you'll give them your credit card, and they actually, Wildberry, about 8-10 years ago, had a girl in there that was stealing people's identity and credit card numbers from there. And then most recently, up in Antioch Walmart, and I think the Raleigh Beach Walmart, they had a skimmer on there, so you swipe your credit card, it would capture all the information, and sometimes they won't use it right away. Sometimes they'll wait a year, sometimes they'll wait 2 years, and then they'll have that credit card number and they'll use it.
I've read about medical insurance frauds as well, where people get access to your medical insurance.
Yep.
And use that to have an operation done or, you know, a medical service. Have you run into that?
We haven't had anything like that up this way, so knock on wood.
Yeah.
It'll probably happen tomorrow, though.
You got something? I forgot.
Okay.
We had the scale come around and the pest control sale
around. Oh, yeah.
And they'll tell you that if you pay any price you want for the first time, they do it. And after that, then they'll give you a certain amount.
Yeah. Yeah, it probably was.
Yeah, I went to a friend's house to play cards later. It showed up there too, but I was in the other room.
Oh.
There's a scam too, young guy going around.
Yep.
Okay, the other thing is when you're writing a check, use a pen that can't be erased or you know,
yep.
With water. And make sure that you do the whole line because people, my mother was at a company where there was a temporary person and she took the checks to the bank and she put her name on the line and cashed like about $500 worth of checks.
Yeah, they do that.
Yeah.
It's horrible. Well, so I think we kind of all covered this. Don't throw anything out, by the way.
Yeah.
shred it.
Or shred yourself.
I don't know if anybody uses websites in here and goes to a lot of these, but Craigslist. Craigslist isn't as big nowadays. There's other stuff that's out there. Monster.com, if anybody looks for a part-time job. We just had a lady in the town over. She was on Monster.com, and of course, they said, we'll send you a check, you do the work, and then you send back the rest of the money that isn't used. And she did that, and I think she lost almost $5,000 that the bank didn't help her out either. The bank wouldn't refund the money, so she had to pull her money out of her 401k to replace the money, and yeah, she really, and it was horrible because you can't really trace where they're coming from. eBay's not so big, but you know, a lot of people use it still. Amazon Prime is the new cool thing, right? Singles.net, fling.com, if anybody's looking for a date, match.com, and then plentyoffish.com. Yeah, all of those are really good for these scammers. The lady in Kankakee, where she was getting shipped the five laptops, she actually was a little leery at first with this guy. He was overseas. He was a diamond guy. He was over there getting diamonds, and he was going to fly back, but all of a sudden, the government said, you can't fly back. We need $5,000 from you. And she said, that's a little leery, but okay. So, send $5,000. And then he sends another letter. Hey, they won't let me out unless I reship these computers to a different place, so I want to send them to you. And she's like, okay. But then she started to get a little leery. She started questioning him about where he was, you know, like his name, pictures she wanted, that type of thing. And some of the stories that he was telling her, she would like Google and she'd find a picture of a guy standing in front of a dune, just like he described it. Really, he had a good backstory even before he contacted her. So these guys are that deviously creative that they'll have a backstory before they even contact these people. And they'll all be set up with this information and just like lure them into it. And I think we spent about an hour talking her through this whole thing and showing her that this guy doesn't exist at all.
Question.
Yes.
I recently had my my phone number changed to get away from scammers and other. Is there a way for those kinds of people to find out what my new one is, or
sure.
Am I pretty much secure?
No. It's actually, as a police department, we have several different websites that we can go to and that we pay for as law enforcement people. That we can get phone numbers, brand new phone numbers, cell phone numbers, things like that, of people that we need to contact. These people also have access to these phone numbers, or these websites. And if they pay, not being law enforcement, there's a couple of private investigators that I know that use the same exact website, get the same exact information. So, if you pay enough, you can get the information.
Well, like with phone, with websites that I'm associated with, I left my old phone number out there.
Sure. But if you, that phone number that you have now is linked to utilities, it's all on this other website. Like, so that's how it comes up, because people, I'll use my phone number to get ComEd. So my cell phone, even though I changed it, I may provide it to them. They're going to update it on their system, which is going to update it on this other website. So if people want to get the information, they can get it. You just got to be as secure as possible. And even if they call you and they want to scam you, you don't take the bait, that's no problem. But there is this new thing where they call up and they don't say anything, but you say hello or yes.
Oh, the can you hear me scam?
Yes.
I say hello.
I always do. If I don't know the number, I pick up the phone and I just
got a new twist that we've seen. It's happened both to my husband and me, so I don't think we're imagining it. But you call, you know, when I pick up the phone, I usually wait a few seconds, and if they're not there like that, I hang up again, because I know it's an automated call.
Yep.
And so this new one, they're there, and it sounds like they're dropping their phone or something.
Yeah.
And then, oh, excuse me, I'm sorry, I dropped my phone. Or, oh, I'm sorry, I, you know, whatever. They have something, and then they start talking, and it's recorded.
Yeah.
They, and it's like, after the first couple of seconds, you know, you start saying, I'm not interested, and they're just talking away, you know, it's like, but
yeah,
that's...
I don't even say anything, I just hang up on them.
Well, now I'm that one.
For this and sales calls, the other one, she would say, oh, thank God, I was afraid of the credit collection. I don't want to do business with you.
Here's some other dangerous cellular telephones. I don't know if anybody uses these, but Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, Amigo. I just learned about Amigo. That was kind of a crazy one. It's basically a website where you have anonymous chats with anybody. You just go into this chat room and you can pick like one person, but it's all anonymous. And a lot of these kids are using it. So like granddaughters, grandsons, stuff like that. Have them stay away from like the robot chat, Boo Boo, and Pal Talk. But because what these guys, what these offenders are doing, they're literally getting in there and it's an anonymous. And then they kind of groom these kids. And next thing you know, like one case I just recently had with this girl, she's talking to him, and then all of a sudden his penis shows up on the website. Yeah, I'm like, that's horrible. We contacted them and they're very unwilling to help the police figure out who it is because it's all anonymous. So keep the kids away from that. Common signs of a scam? You won something? How many people have won something?
Oh, yeah.
A lottery. Send me $1,000 and I'll send you the stuff.
Yeah, we believe send you $5.
Yeah. Security reasons for these victims from speaking with anybody about the scam. Very poor wording, grammar, and punctuation. Ever get one of those emails? They're fun to read.
Your spell checkers are getting better.
Then they ask the victim for money or personal information before giving anything in return. Again, the lottery scams. Some long lost cousin that was a royal prince has died and you're going to get it. Never happens. It's too good to be true. Probably is a scam. So, that's always my favorite.
What about sweepstakes? You ever got a sweepstakes thing that was a scam?
Yeah. When they first came out, we got a lot of them. So the buyer targeted scams, again, buying something, not receiving it. This is my boss. So he went to buy a pet, a bulldog, years and years ago, before any of the scams became really huge. But sent this lady in Ohio money for a bulldog. And she's like, oh yeah, it'll be on the next plane. Gave the flight number, everything. He went down, never picked it up. Oh, okay, well, we missed the flight. It's gonna be on this one. Goes down there, never. He was out like $500.
Yeah. I'll teach him
that. So he sends his payment to the fraudster, and the fraudster cashes the payment, but never sends him back. Literally, this is him. Seller targeted scams. Agrees to buy a pet, the seller. This is the bad check one, where they send more money in this check and then you're supposed to send back the refunded amount. So, and that's where you get jammed up with your banks. You take the money out, the check comes back as no good. Now you're stuck holding the bag and you've sent all this money away. And then they make up with the refund, the bad check. Have anybody heard of the secret shoppers? Do you know? Anybody get those emails?
What?
A lot of them come on. The secret shoppers.
Secret.
Yeah. You get emails for them. Hey, you got a really great job. We'll give you money. You go in and you taste their food or you buy their product. selling it correctly. So, get hired, you receive the fraudulent check, ask to wire the funds to a third party and keep the rest as payment, and then they use copyrighted logos. And is it, anybody seen like those shows? A lot of the news companies will do like 60 Minutes or 20 Minutes. They used to do them back in the 80s and the 90s, where they'd have like First Midwest Bank, they'd show their logo, and then they'd have right next to it almost an identical logo, but it's just off by a tiny bit. That's the fraudster logo, logos that they create, and they make it just so it's just tiny bit different, but without realizing it, you think you're looking at an actual logo. And they put it on letterhead, or they put it on emails, and they send it out to you. Work from home or reshipping scams, we've had a lot of these. Victim response to an ad for employment, they're hired by the fraudulent company, and they receive shipments at home that are forwarded to an international address. Kind of goes along with the whole romance scams that are out there. And then the victim later learns that the goods were bought with fraudulent credit cards. So, charity scams usually start with a spam email. Has anybody ever gotten those? Or even phone calls. Hey, we're with your local FOP lodge and we'd like you to donate money.
I have a question that just reminded me. 2 years after we moved here, at Christmas time, the first year, you get a phone call from some supposedly local person and saying, you know, she's a veteran and she needs help buying Christmas presents for her kids. And the first year I said no because we had just moved. So then the next year I got another phone call from the same person. He said, hoping you're having a better year, would you be willing to help me out? And I just said no, but it's like, this is crazy.
Yeah, they're relentless.
Are they?
Yeah.
How about the one from the police department?
Yeah, the FOPs.
Yeah.
Here's my thought, and they've even gotten me. I'm always like, I work for the police department. If I want to donate to my own police department, I'm going to give them the money directly.
Good.
So, if you really want to donate to a certain charity, go to that charity. These guys that they call there and they pretend to be with the charity or with an FOP or or a fire department one.
And some of them are actually really charities, but they're so like 98% goes to their administration or whatever, and like 2% actually goes to help anybody.
Right.
But legally, they're technically charities.
Yeah, that's why I take the money directly to that charity and say, donate this.
My thing is, first of all, I don't acknowledge that I'm the person that they're trying to get to.
Yeah.
Okay? And then I say, she doesn't do anything over the phone.
Yep,
and
that's good.
Hang up. I mean, but you don't know who's on the other side, and you can do it.
Exactly.
By you initiating.
Yep.
How about the ones that stand at the exit from the grocery store? Are they always good?
Salvation Army?
No.
Unless I'm actually handing it to, like, I know that, what is it, the guys with the red kettles?
Salvation Army.
Yeah, the Salvation Army. If I'm going to give to them, I'm actually going to take my money to them. Who knows where that money goes? When it leaves your hand and it goes with those guys, you don't know. And I'm not saying that everybody's bad. I am a police officer, so I automatically think leery of everybody.
There's a homeless guy on the corner of Delaney with a McDonald's.
He's now a female.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
He stands there and he asks him.
Yes.
He says he's down in the corner, he gets money.
Yep.
As soon as he gets money, he goes to the McDonald's.
Yes.
I said, he makes about $100 a day.
Honestly, he's the most clean-cut homeless person I've ever seen. That's why I'm a little leery about that.
Yeah, he's always standing out there.
He is. He moved out into Waukegan, though, now. He's out there. But the other day, I drove by there, and there's a female standing out there, and I watched her as she walked to her nice car to get in it and leave. I'm like, come on.
Well, that makes a couple hundred dollars.
Yeah, I'm good with people that actually need charity, and I will work to help them out. So, but... You know, everybody's trying to scam the system, and they make quite a bit of money.
Yeah.
so.
I've seen cars stop.
Yeah.
50 hours.
Like my partner and I, when we go to the city, we usually take about 5 bags of stuff for homeless people that are actually homeless. And we find the homeless people, like, we'll give them a bag and it's got some, you know, bars in it, blanket, whatever he packs into it. But we go down there and we do that. But that guy is, you know, very clean cut.
Yeah. My guy will not give cash for charity, because for all, I mean, for the individual. Maybe if I lose it, so true. Should we give him a coupon from McDonald's?
Yeah.
Right, that's what we are charging.
Or if you really want to do it, go buy the McDonald's and hand it to him.
Yeah.
The Lions Club gives you a tissue box.
Yep.
You're in the Lions Club, so that's, you know, that's a legitimate.
Yeah. Oh, I get that, because I, my partners are from the Lions Club here in Grays Lake. And they do a lot of good charity stuff.
Who's your partner?
Joe Holtz, Chuck Foy, Matt Gore.
Oh, okay.
Amy, they all do the, I think Amy does the steer roast when it comes up, so. But again, if I'm gonna get money, I'm gonna take it right to the Lions Club and give it to them.
Gurney Mills is a dangerous place too.
Yeah.
I have a condo in Gurney Mills. They were zero help.
Yeah. So senders claim to work for charity, but they never actually give money to the charity again. He being Larry, not giving. This could be over the phone or door to door. Anybody have people come to their door and ask for money?
Yes.
Here's the romance fraud. Fraudster meets the victim on a social site, usually lives in another country. Promises to visit if the victim sends money to pay for the trip. And then fraudster invariably can't come and will continue to solicit money until the victim realizes that they are not going to come, never going to make that trip. So again, that was that guy with the Kankakee lady, never coming. Probably never, you know. It was probably two or three people they kept talking to her. I'm sure they have. Did anybody ever see, I think 2020 or 60 Minutes did one, where the Nigerians, they were working with the Nigerian police and they went and they raided people. And it was all these people sitting in this hut on computers, sitting on the dirt floor, just totally defrauding people of money, defrauding, you know, doing the romance scams, everything. Fraudster already has a story put in place and one variation from the scam within the United States. Fraudsters will lure the victim to a location while the victim's residence is being burglarized. So they'll actually go on a date if it's a local person. And inevitably, you share stuff when you think you're in a romance that maybe you shouldn't, like your home address, where you live, what town, when you're going to be out, and these guys will go and they'll rob you, break into your house.
That was the Craigslist killer.
Yes.
He went to the real estate people.
Yep.
And met somebody and then killed her.
Yep. So.
Yes.
Here's some phishing
yes.
scams, emails. Sent-seeking sensitive personal information. They've gone from emails to now just calling you and saying you have a virus on your computer. Sent by fraudsters posing as legitimate businesses. Examples are banks. Sometimes uses threats to scare the victim, providing information. Once information is obtained, it is used for identity theft or other fraudulent purposes. They'll open up credit cards, they'll open up mortgages. Buy a car. Again, my boss. So, see how the First Citizens Bank, I've never heard of the First Citizens Bank.
Oh, yeah.
So, and they're just trying to get money for him. About his account that's about to expire. He doesn't even have the account. So, telephone phishing scams. Fraudsters will pose as legitimate representatives of a company, Microsoft. They'll explain that there's a virus detected on your computer. Again, I'm sitting at my desk. Fraudster will instruct the victim to download malicious software that could capture passwords, contacts, or other sensitive information. They'll charge to remove that software, and now they got the victim's credit card along with any passwords, anything you've done on the computer, they just collect it. Here's the, we've already kind of talked about some of these, but the family member in jail or injured, and inevitably, they can never talk to their grandson, granddaughter, son, daughter. They pretend to have a relative who is injured or in jail, make it sound as if they are urgent or they're desperate. Professors will play with the victim's emotions, and they'll request that money be sent. Professors will contact, oh, these green dots. Has anybody ever heard of the green dots scams?
Yeah.
My favorite was the IRS wanting iTunes cards.
Walmart.
Pay for our taxes in those now, apparently.
Credit cards.
Yeah. So these are green dots. They're reloadable cards that you can buy at Walgreens. And you can just put money onto them continuously. And that's what these fraudsters will do. They'll actually call, hey, somebody's in jail. We need these green dot cards. You give me the number. They can go online. They can capture that number. And then they will be able to get the money out of the green dot account. So they'll contact the victim in regards to winning a vehicle or another prize. They'll request that the money be put on these green dot reloadable cards. And again, you can purchase these at the Walgreens, the CVS's. They'll ask for the information, and then they'll have the account and the money.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, the green dot cards sound like a kind of a way to reduce your exposure. If you buy them for your own purposes for, say, put $100 on it.
Yeah.
If somebody gets that number, the most they can get is $100.
Correct.
They can't get
right.
your whole credit card.
Right. But what these guys are doing is they're playing on the emotion to add more money.
Right.
So
I've read on Facebook where they've asked like an old woman to go and buy like $5,000 worth to send to them, and when she went to the store or wherever she went to buy them, the person that she, you know, she was going to pay alerted her to the fact that it was a scam. So that's how they don't just ask for $100 for some people. They have this story.
We got contacted by a couple of years ago by one of the local banks. They're like, hey, this lady keeps taking hundreds of dollars out, and she's sending it someplace. We think this
main
is a fraud. They thought it was a fraud. We actually went and we talked to her, literally got into an argument with her about it, because she thought it was legitimate. You know, there's only so much that we can do. We can't stop her from doing it. But we can go ahead and we can contact family members to try and get them help with their finances and let them know that this is not a good thing.
People also come to your home.
Come to your
especially
home.
Especially if you're a senior.
Yes.
And they're going to do the driveway.
Yeah.
That's why I asked you about the gypsies.
Well, those
my
are the
neighbor
gypsies.
Had it.
Yeah. And those guys, some of them are legit, some of them aren't.
Right.
But a lot of times if they're showing up on your doorstep,
there's something wrong.
Yeah, a lot, and one of the other scams for the gypsies is the roofing.
Yes.
Hey,
yes.
Your roof is all messed up. Let me show you in the back. And while you're in the back talking to somebody, their partners are going in the front door and they're stealing
valuables. I taught at Lincolnwood. And Lincolnwood, there is a little plate that goes on your license plate.
Yeah.
Okay? Well, there were three families that went from Lincolnwood down to Florida and stopped along the way. And the police had pictures of them going into like a 7-Eleven. And about seven would go in at one point, and one would get the cashier's attention, and then the others would walk through.
Yep.
But they traced them through the license plate, and then they contacted the police in Lincolnwood, and we knew who the families were.
Oh,
you
yeah.
know, just who was, you know.
Yeah, it's crazy.
With that.
Yeah.
I had somebody in Waukegan came to the door, and he said he needed some money. His sister was in the hospital, and he needed some money, and lived on the street. I said, show me the other address. Walked away.
Yeah. Once you start questioning him and you don't have answers for it, you really walk away. This is one of the ones that you gotta be careful of because you can never see it. Credit card skimming machines. And basically it's a device used to hold credit card information. It can be attached to an ATM or used by an employee at a retail establishment or a restaurant. And the information can be held by fraudsters for several years before use. The information can be reprinted on the new credit cards and they can use those credit cards. And this is kind of old, but Lake Forest, Antioch, Ernie, Waukegan, all have had them. If you go to, usually they're at gas stations. If you go to the gas station, a lot of the ones that have been hit with these skimmers, because they don't just put them on the outside, they actually open the door and put them on the inside so you can't see them. A lot of these, I saw them at BP down at 45 and 120. They put a piece of tape across it, across the opening. If it's broken, somebody's tampered with it, but if it's like a seal.
Yes. Costco does that to all their gas pumps.
Yep.
And there's like five different places on the pump.
Yep.
And I was talking to the guy one time and he said they go around and check every hour to make sure that they're all still
intact. Yeah, because it takes, and here's what we learned, is that the key to open those is a universal key for all of them.
Oh, so nice.
You get one key, you can open them all.
I heard that because of that, they suggest putting your gas closer to the building because it's easier for them to drink something that's far away.
Yep. Just like the felony lane gang where they'll cash checks, they'll go to the outside because there's less of a chance of actually video surveillance.
They did it at Michael's.
Michael's?
Yeah, put skimming on.
Yeah, they do it all
in
over the
northern
places.
Suburbs. They did it. But it's Michael's horrible. Didn't tell the people that it was done.
Yeah, Chipotle, they just got caught. Somebody got into their website and got credit card information.
Yeah,
so.
TJ Maxx, Marshalls, they had a big scam.
Yeah.
Here's
the Canadian lottery scam. Send unsolicited spam emails claiming the victim is one. Some form of international lottery. Victim is told to contact the lottery employees. A victim is then told to claim their winnings. Yeah. They must pay taxes, fees, or they will be dispersed. So, if anybody gets any lottery, unless you pay for it, probably didn't win it. So, here's kind of a little overview of what you might get as an email from them for the Canadian lottery scam.
What about that guy that keeps coming around wanting you to switch from ComEd to theirs?
Those guys with the...
Usually has it on an iPad, has your account and all that stuff. First time it was paper, second time it was like an iPad.
Yeah, something like it, yeah.
Could be legitimate, but...
Yeah, I never do it. Unless I call and want the information, I don't want you showing up at my door.
Yeah.
Nigerian scams. Money from wills. Fraudster claims that he's just received a large inheritance but cannot deposit the money into a Nigerian bank. Because apparently they're corrupt. They ask for assistance in depositing the money in an American bank because they're not corrupt. Fraudster agrees to give the victim a portion of the inheritance, several million dollars, if the victim assists them. So. Here's the contract fraud. Fraudsters enter an agreement with the victim regarding the shipment of goods to Nigeria or other countries. Fraudster states that he will pay COD. Fraudster never pays, and the victim is out the cost of the goods and the shipping fees. Transfer of contract funds. Fraudster sends unsolicited emails to victim claiming to be a senior civil servant in Nigeria, and they're seeking an individual or company where he can deposit funds that his company was overpaid by the Nigerian government, usually tens of thousands of dollars. Fraudster will solicit sensitive information, bank account stuff. They will either use this information or continue with an additional scam. And this involves claiming that the victim needs to front the money for the transfer to go through. So if you're not contacting them, throwing bait out there and hoping somebody, you snag somebody.
I mean, if you watch Law and Order Criminal Minds, you know that these people are doing things like this.
Yeah.
You know, but...
Yeah, there's no real profile, it's just sending it out there, they send out thousands and thousands.
My wife was buying some tickets off of a legitimate church internet site.
No, it was not.
It was some type of a, but anyway, she bought the ticket. It was for the church, but it was another company was handling it.
Yeah.
Eventbrite.
Eventbrite.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, she bought, and within about 20 minutes later, we got a charge from Harbor Freight from California.
Oh, yeah.
We had to change our credit card.
Yeah.
Well, no, it showed up.
Yeah, it showed up on our...
With my credit cards, I will get an alert.
Alert, yeah, somebody's messing around.
Yeah, I have that alert too.
Yeah, we have that alert.
But we noticed it.
Yeah.
We had our card changed and all.
That's a mess.
Yeah, Eventbrite is usually pretty secure, they do a lot of our police stuff, so...
Yeah.
Maybe somebody's...
Who knows where I got scammed, yes.
Yeah. Well, like I said, they don't have to do it right away, they can hold it for a couple of years.
Never mind.
Continuing with this, fraudsters may request that the victim travel to Nigeria. Once there, the victim will be told that unforeseen taxes, fees are going to cost the victim even more money. And the victim usually pays, hoping that the money will eventually be transferred to their account, which it never is. Sometimes it involves threat or violence. And I know, like, now all of a sudden the IRS is calling and saying, they're going to show up at your doorstep. That's kind of a threat. People get scared. So,
have you seen things like this in Lee County?
Like these? Yeah. We get them, but people don't actually fall for them. So, yeah. It's more of the Nigerian scams. You can tell, just like reading this, really horrible sentence structure and...
People working out in Nigeria.
Yeah. Well, now it's kind of all over. Before it was like, you know, they claim it to be the Nigerian scams because that's where it started. But now it's just all over the world. It could be your neighbor.
And if they want to reply, write it for English, translate it to Nigeria, and send that to them.
Actually, when we get these, we like to play with them in our police department. We'll send stuff back to them.
Lester's done
that. That's the asshole.
Yeah, it's fun. Here's the new one. Some of the new stuff. This is in Lake County, where they issued a warning about phone scammers posing as court officers for Lake County Sheriff's Department. So, again, hey, your grandson, your granddaughter's in jail. They need this amount of money. So it's even happening in Lake County.
Have you heard about actual fake police stopping people in Lake County?
Yeah, there's been nothing more recent, but there was actually a guy...
pretends to be a police officer.
Yeah, he actually stopped one of our... At the time, he was a patrolman. He actually stopped his wife. Ended up... he basically pulled her out of the car and searched her, and while searching her, she fumbled her, so it just spawned a huge investigation.
Good.
And we spent months and months trying to figure out who that guy was. He disappeared off the face of the earth once it went on the internet. So. This is actually my property room. These are in focus projectors that actually made it all the way to England on a scam. And we paid to have them brought back to Illinois. And I think we sold everything but about four of them. We've had computers that have been brought back to us. We've gone and gotten computers. So it runs rampant. It's a daily thing. Here's the Can You Hear Me scam, published in January 2017. So they can use your voice to open up phone, utility, credit cards, just saying yes. Five rules of avoiding a Nigerian scam. Never pay for anything up front for any reason. Never extend credit for any reason.
because I remembered reading an article not long ago that said a person had done that, but what actually happened was they cleared it, but a week or two later, bank's audit folks came up with the fact that this was not legit, and came after the person who thought they had been smart by waiting 2-3 days or whatever until the check apparently had cleared. So you can't even just assume that if you wait 2-3 days and there's no feedback from the bank, that it's a good check.
Yeah, even recently, a business owner in Lindenhurst got a credit card. They ran the credit card. It appeared to be a good number. It appeared to be an active credit card. He did the transaction with the people, and then 2 days later, he was notified the credit card was bad. So even that takes a couple of days. So, protecting yourself, if you did not order it, pay for it, or expect it, then it's most likely a scam. Think like a thief, that's what you guys got to do. Shred, tear, destroy all your information before it makes to your garbage. I have a shredder right next to my computer. Well, actually, right next to my receptacle for, you know, papers and stuff like that. I just shred it right into it. And then I make my wife shake it up before I throw it out. Don't save any passwords on your computer. Always check your credit history for discrepancies. You can get, like, I know there's some credit card companies that are offering free credit histories and stuff like that. I always check mine. Check with your personal bank if you have any questions about online banking. A lot of people get their alerts and stuff like that off their credit cards. And never carry more credit cards than you need or cancel unused accounts. Yes, sir?
I have a comment on the storing passwords. I store all my passwords on my computer, but they're in an encrypted file. And in addition, all of my passwords that I've stored are only part of the password. Mm-hmm. The rest of it's up here.
There you go.
And this is not very hackable.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe in a bar, but
never know.
I don't go to bars, so not a problem.
A little alcohol. Don't throw away any bills or documents containing account information. Never leave receipts behind. Cross-check them with your credit card bills. Don't carry your social security card and don't disclose it unless necessary. And then there's the 188 opt-out, if anybody does that. I think there's a couple of other ones that are out there too that you can call. Yeah.
Okay.
But here's what's funny is I've done that, but then I show up on other different websites and I'm like, you just can't.
I have, we have identity theft protection through First American Bank.
Yep.
It's about, I think about $14 a month. Then I had to do all the entries of all my stuff, like the mortgage and all the stuff. So I had about like 30 entries. So I will get an alert if somebody's compromising stuff.
LifeLock is pretty good, I hear. So.
It was more expensive. Like LifeLock, this one is even better than LifeLock. Somebody in here mentioned LifeLock was a scam.
Yeah.
I don't know if it is or not, but I had them for years. I canceled them.
Yep.
And the only one to be to stay. But then my bank offered this. It's cheaper and I get more.
Right.
Yeah.
I noticed that at least one of my credit card companies now doesn't put the whole account number on the statement.
Yeah.
Right.
They should just put X's in the last four.
Yeah. So,
last four. Yep. So kind of to do a little review, these are just a sampling of scams. Every day they're coming up with new ones. All these guys do is think of a scam. Best way to avoid being a victim, being victimized, is to stay informed just so that you guys are doing it. Good. Protect yourself. If it sounds too good, it most likely is. And then I'll leave this up here for a few. But these are all some of the places that you can go to. So yeah. The big one is if you think it's a scam and you just want to even, you're not sure, you can always call us and we can come over and talk to you.
I've seen on Dr. Phil's show a couple of times where
other stuff to Amazon, and there's a lot of other sites I need to do with it, too, so.
Yeah.
No, it's free, and then what I do is I get a code, they send me a code to my phone.
Okay.
Then they know it's me.
Okay.
Because there's, I easily get scammed.
Always something, yeah.
We'll figure out another way.
Any other questions?
Excellent, Steve, thank you very much.
Thank you.